The liquid phase is something that always fascinates me. It's about a year that I'm trying to reproduce these irregular states of matter without succeed. Every fluid at a macroscopic level can be perfectly described by the Navier-Stokes equation. The solution of those equations is very tough. It represents one of the 7 millennium prize problem, so for sure I will not find it. Also, a numerical solution to the problem requires a lot of math out of my reach. I have to find another approach, so I must think more in details about liquids. Each liquid, like water, is formed by tiny molecules like this one. Depending on the liquid considered, the dimension of the molecule changes from less than a nanometer to hundreds of nanometers. I will take, as a model for this video, the water molecule, formed by an oxygen atom and two atoms of hydrogen. As you can imagine, in a single droplet of water, there are billions of billions of billions of those molecules, and simulate all of them will be impossible. But that's not a big problem. Let us consider only a small portion of these molecules, and let us try to understand some important features. The molecules are not fixed in space, but they can move around and interact with other molecules. Each interaction is represented by a line. Every time a line appears, it means that a force is acting equally on both particles. If the particles are far away, the force will attract the molecules. If the particles are too close, the force will repulse them. The forces are generated by electrostatic interaction, and they will converge the two water particles towards an equilibrium situation, where the attraction and repulsion are perfectly balanced. If we have three molecules, the equilibrium is a triangle configuration. If we have four of them, the equilibrium is a square. But what about 10 particles? This configuration does not reach any stable equilibrium, but a dynamic solution with 3 molecules inside and 7 outside is still possible. Then, what happens with 100 particles? Since the total number of interactions grows exponentially with the number of molecules, we reach a real mess on the screen. More important, the computer can't calculate quick enough the acceleration of each particle and starts to lag. Maybe it's time to waste this approach. Not so fast. Since the forces will scale with distance, if two particles are far away, the presence or absence of a connection line will not give rise to a big error. With this idea in mind, we can create circles around the liquid points, and only the molecules inside those circles can give rise to a proper force. I transfer the whole system in a simple environment, a rectangular box, with one simple rule. If one of the molecules comes too close to the surface of the box, it inverts its velocity and loses some of its kinetic energy. The circles are only visual instruments to better understand what is going on, but without them, all continue to work in the same way. Let's also insert a gravity force in this environment that pushes down all the molecules. By properly tuning the number of particles, the amplitude of the electrostatic force, the radius of action, and the dissipating energy, I obtain a liquid simulator to be proud of. The only problem now is graphics. When I look at real liquid, they not appear like a set of bubbles that moves around, but they appear like a continuum material. To reach such a result, I try textural approach. I want to create an image formed by hundreds of pixels that will simulate the fluid aspect. First of all, I create a grid inside the box with a tunable subdivision. Each rectangle represents a pixel of the final image. More pixels mean a better resolution, but also more computation is required, and a trade-off must be found. We can color each pixel in the following way. We create a color square that covers different pixels around the molecule considered. Then we add another square still centered in the molecule position, but with a side slightly smaller than the previous one, and we repeat the process over and over again. As I mentioned before, more rectangles translate in a better resolution. If you do this operation for all the particles, we obtain an image like this. The image changes at every updating frame, creating a video. Now, what is important is the texture and no more the molecules, so I decide to hide them. This approach results in a realistic behavior when there are a lot of water molecules, for example in the bottom part of the box. Where instead there are single particles, the rectangular shape that appears is very ugly. My solution is to introduce a threshold. Only the part of the grid with an intensity bigger than a tunable value is visible. I also change a bit the color, and the final result has for sure its charm. The grid subdivision of the space has another advantage. It's possible to convert an external object into a non-available pixel. Every time a molecule is close to one of those pixels and try to reach it, it will change its velocity as it happens with a wall. With this small detail, we can easily simulate the water that falls into a glass. Another possibility is to just insert one or two objects in the previous box and watch the simulation. If you want to play with this simulation, you will find the code in the description below. I love how natures always surpass my imagination.